Hi, everybody. My name is Nicole Martinez. I am one of the transplant coordinators, like Callie, here at the Colorado Blood Cancer Institute. I'm going to take you through the rest of the presentation today. We're going to talk a little bit about what it's like after you discharge from the hospital, some signs and symptoms to look for one of our biggest complications. And then we're going to touch a bit on caregiver responsibilities, and that's why you're all hopefully watching this presentation, is to learn what you have to do to take care of your loved one when they come home. I really encourage you to take notes during this, write questions, because at the very end of the entire presentation, there will be a slide with contact information so you can reach out to the appropriate coordinator with your questions. Unfortunately, we don't have a live forum where you can reach out to us right now, so please make sure you're writing down your questions. All right, so Callie talked to you guys a bit about what it's like to be in the hospital and how we get you there. My job today is to tell you how we take you beyond that. So when you come outpatient to the clinic, as you all know by now, you're gonna have to stay locally if you don't already live here within 20 miles of the hospital. One of the reasons of that is because you're gonna be coming to the clinic fairly frequently. As you discharge from the hospital, you're gonna be seen in the clinic at least twice a week. That's you and your caregiver that will be coming. At this time is when we need that 24/7 caregiver. And when I say 24/7, although you may find your coordinator and doctor make you some wiggle room, we mean 24/7. We have to have someone that's with you, within earshot, within a visual, to make sure that you are as safe as possible during this high-risk time after transplant. I'm not saying someone has to come get right in your face all day. Are you doing okay? Are you doing fine? Do you need something? No. We just have to make sure that someone's making sure that they're taking care of all these responsibilities that we're going to talk about here in a little bit. At least 100 days, you're going to be coming to our clinic before we release you back to your referring physicians. And that's 100 days after your day zero. So when Callie showed you that master calendar earlier where we did the launch control countdown to the day zero, that's when we start counting at 100 days. So some of that time, you're in the hospital. Usually another 2 to 3 weeks of your 100 days, you're here with us and we are your caregivers. So I want to make sure that you guys understand that after the hospital, it's about 2 months, a little over 2 months that we're requiring that caregiver. But everyone's a little different, so please keep that in mind. If you're having complications that need more monitoring, we require that caregiver longer. And occasionally, though, I don't want to make you any promises, if you're doing very well, we lift that precaution slightly early and let you kind of get back to more normal activities. One of the people you're going to meet after transplant is going to be your post-allo transplant coordinator. It's a nurse like me, but they specialize in mission control. Their job is to take you beyond the transplant and help monitor all those side effects and long-term things so you have a point of contact. It's a very nice group. You'll probably see a little bit of all of them, but each of the physicians we work with has one specific post-transplant coordinator who will help monitor your care. When you come to your first visit at the clinic, and you guys don't have to remember this at this moment, you will be reminded with your discharge teaching. But when you come to the clinic for your first visit, we ask that you bring all of those prescription medications in their bottles to the clinic visit with you. And the reason we'd like you to do that is because even though you're going to get teaching in the hospital, they're going to run through the med list, a pharmacist is going to speak with you about those. Sometimes when you come to the clinic, there's something missing. And we want to make sure that everything we've prescribed for you is included, you know how to take it, and you actually have that medication, because we sometimes make adjustments to those. This disclaimer, now you'll see this disclaimer on this slide, and Callie mentioned it earlier. You're going to have this beautiful line placed in your chest. You're going to have gotten used to it and know that it's magical because we can draw blood from it, give your medications through it, and use it for those great purposes. But outpatient, at least once a week, we're going to have you have your blood drawn through your arm. And the reason we do that is those immunosuppression medications, which we'll talk a little bit more about, we have to monitor the level of those medications. Those medications are given IV in the hospital. They go through that line, and the medication tends to stick. And unfortunately, human error means that sometimes that medication touches all three of those lines at some point during your stay. And so we like to draw the line through the, or draw the blood, excuse me, through the arm so that we have a more accurate level. So when you come to the clinic and the nurses tell you to take your arm out and you say, no, I have this line, remember that we warned you and don't take it out on them. During this time, your post-transplant coordinator is going to help manage those immunosuppressive medications. They're going to talk to you and help monitor for graft versus host disease, which we're going to go into more detail about. And they're going to manage your electrolytes and help you schedule your visits. So they're your new go-to person. Things that you need for your clinic visit, and this is one of those really important responsibilities for caregivers, is the patients don't always remember everything they're supposed to bring with them. So important things for caregivers to remember for visits are the medication list. You do not have to bring that bag full of the pill bottles to every single visit. Some people are comfortable doing that, but it's not required. We want to make sure that you have a running document of the medications you're taking, how often you're taking them, and what doses, because we do change that list occasionally. We want to make sure that you always bring the most up-to-date list. We also want you bringing your blood band. It's a bracelet that they'll give you when you leave the hospital. It says what your blood type is. And then most of you are familiar with the blood band number that's specific to you. So when you do need transfusions, we can use that number. A jacket or sweater. The clinic tends to be a little cold. It's an old building. And although we tell you we can control the temperature, we have no control. We try. So bring a jacket or sweater, something to read. Some of the rooms have TVs in them, so if you're going to be there for a long visit, we can certainly try to get you into a room where there's a little more entertainment, but bring something to read or an iPad or something to keep yourself busy. Something to eat. We have snacks. We usually have cheese, snack boxes, Jell-O. We're fully stocked with easy microwave kind of cook meals. But if there's something specific you like or you know will hold you over or you're just really craving, you're always welcome to bring snacks to the clinic. A list of your appointments, we print those out for you every time you come if you need that list. And then we need your person acting as a caregiver. So the caregivers is one of the primary reasons we offer this presentation. And we really need them to come with you to all of your appointments outpatient, because they are your second set of ears that helps you remember what has changed and what we're doing next. So don't forget those people. They're very important. In the outpatient setting, that supportive care continues. So the things Callie talked about inpatient, we do outpatient, and hopefully we can keep you that way. So we support your IV fluids. We give you antibiotics, the antifungals, antivirals, that whole slew of medications to help keep you safe after transplant. We monitor those side effects. Most patients, if not all, will be on home IV fluids. So with that electrolyte imbalance, sometimes that's very long-term. And we have you go home on IV fluids that usually have electrolytes mixed in with them. For some patients, and the guys, this is insurance dependent, it's doctor preference, there's all sorts of different ways to give IV fluids. For some patients, that's a pump that they wear and it will continuously go through that nice line. For some patients, it's an IV bag that they hang up at home, an infusion nurse helps or educates your caregiver on how to administer that medication. And for some patients, they have to come to the clinic every day or every other day to get that medication. But don't be surprised when you need home IV fluids, because that's something pretty common after transplant. And then we manage your side effects, even longer. Now, this is everybody's favorite subject. After transplant, we have to continue bone marrow biopsies. The bone marrow biopsies do a lot of things for us. They help us monitor the progress of your disease, hopefully showing that the transplant has done its job, and they do another test that we'll talk about in a second. Bone marrow biopsies we do monthly for the first 3 months. We do them at days 30, 60, 90, 6 months, sometimes 9 months, and 12 months, we do the bone marrow biopsies. So again, we're monitoring for disease progression and hopefully find that it's not there. And the other thing we do is a special test called a chimerism. So a chimerism, you guys are going to hear that term a lot after transplant. This is a lab that shows us how much of the cells your bone marrow is producing belong to your donor and how much belong to you. And what we're hoping to see over time is that when we get that test back, we see 100% donor cells and the original cells aren't there anymore. So for anybody who has an opposite sex donor, so if you're a man and you're getting your stem cells from a woman, your DNA will now show a female DNA. It doesn't mean you get to make excuses and do anything female-like, but you will have a female DNA. It will not change your personality. So Don't do that. And vice versa, if you're a woman and you're getting a man's cells, you will show a male DNA from here on out. And that's what we want to see. And that's what this study tells us, okay?